Melissa, it's starting. Come on.
Hello there. Welcome to worship. My name is Karen Taylor, and I'm the ministry coordinator at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church in New Prague, Minnesota. For the next 5 minutes, it is my goal to share what you need to know about Holy Trinity. I'm going to be sharing the highs and the lows and everything in between. So let's get started. I always start out here on our website. It's found at holytrinityonline.org. And I want to scroll down just a little bit. I've added a new button. There is some new COVID-19 updates. All of these updates, I think, are going to be mailed to you, but you can also find them here on our website. I am going to also start on our newsletter. So as you scroll over to the Welcome tab, you can go down here and navigate to Newsletters, and then click on the date. So this week, we are celebrating Thanksgiving. We are celebrating giving thanks to the giver of all. So this week we have a great article written by Pastor Ben about grief and gratitude. We kind of have that juxtaposition this year, especially with the recent pause that the governor did this last week. So we will all be huddling into our own homes with no big family gatherings, and restaurants are going to be shutting down, but we will persevere. We can do this. I want to give a quick shout out to whoever anonymously donated the radio sponsorship this week in honor of John Berquist, Jamie Bezik, Jim Cody, Donna Galvin, Deb Miller, and myself. So thank you so much. That is truly, truly appreciated. So we look forward to hearing that radio broadcast on our local radio station, K-Check. So as we scroll through the newsletter, lots of new things that you need to know for this week. Here's another paragraph about that COVID-19 update. So as you click through here, you'll see there's some top three questions that you can get answered, and then a letter from Pastor Ben and Pastor Alicia. There's my newsletter. Find it again. Easy, easy. As you scroll through the rest of the newsletter, you'll see we have our grieving update. I do want to point out there's two little asterisks there. That does not include our current building project money. We kept that out so that the numbers wouldn't get messed up. So those are the actual year-to-date numbers for our revenue and our expenses. The sharing tree, we are winding down. There's only two more Mondays that people can donate clothing. Now, I must point out, Mary and Julie have been getting a lot of phone calls about what type of clothing. It needs to be brand new with tags, and a gift receipt would be very, very helpful to these families. So those drop-off times are Monday evenings from 6 to 7 p.m. So there will be a car. You don't have to worry about touching anybody or getting too close. You can just put it in the trunk and be off on your way. We have a Thanksgiving meal that's coming up this Sunday, this afternoon, after worship. You need to call Donna, though, and make sure that there's still meals available. She was running out of space, so hopefully if you're seeing this on Sunday morning, hopefully you already have your reservation if you want to pick up that Thanksgiving meal. We handed out our Advent kits this past weekend. That's super exciting. So hopefully all of you will be taking time sometime this week to make those Advent logs special and memorable with your family. Christmas tea Plan B. Make sure you sign up for this. Registration is required. So there is still gonna be a hostess, and that hostess is gonna invite 5 guests. This year, it's gonna be all online. So a pre-recorded program is going to be premiering on the Facebook page on Sunday, December 10th at 10 a.m., so right after worship. And all of the ladies that are participating are going to watch it together. We can communicate online and give each other, you know, little hugs and little hearts and all sorts of fun emojis while we listen to this inspirational message. We also have our survey results back. You can read more of that. So all of the good news is happening or located on our website. So make sure you check that out at holytrinityonline.org. Enjoy your day.
Welcome to Holy Trinity Lutheran Church.
Good morning. Welcome to worship at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church of New Prague, Minnesota. My name is Ben Hilding. My partner Alicia and I are co-pastors here. It's good to be gathered with you today in worship. Today is a day we prepare for Thanksgiving. We're thinking about Christmas. We're wondering what it's going to look like this year. And while we count our blessings, we recognize too that we're missing out on some things as well. And so we're thinking about this concept of grief and gratitude. Grief and gratitude at the same time, and we're going to talk about that more in a few minutes. But first, let's join together in our opening hymn, Praise and Thanksgiving. Now let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Most merciful God, we confess
that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves.
We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
By what we have done and by what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole hearts.
We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
Forgive us, renew us, and lead us,
so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
To the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority alone, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Today for our special music, we've got a little throwback piece here from Barb Gullickson and her granddaughter Maya.
I'll count to two and we come in on three. One, two.
Thank you, Maya, and thank you, Barb. Now let us turn to the Word of God found in Scripture.
A reading from Ephesians, the first chapter. I have heard of your faiths in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put his power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
A reading from Matthew, the 25th chapter. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took a flask of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout. Look, there is a bridegroom. Come out to meet him. Then all the bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise replied, no, there will not be enough for you and for us. You better go to the dealerships and go buy some for yourselves. And while they went to go buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he replied, Truly, I tell you, I don't know you. Keep away therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. The word of the Lord.
A reading from Matthew, the 25th chapter. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. The word of the Lord.
So I was listening to KTIS the other day, and I have to say I like KTIS. I'm usually up to date on the latest artists, the latest songs, the top 40 contemporary Christian songs, and I love tuning in to KTIS. And as I was listening, they said their mantra, encouraging and uplifting music for you and your whole family, right? And then came on this song by Toby Mac. This song by Toby Mac is a song of grief and lamentation because this artist named Toby Mac, who used to be a part of DC Talk, which I loved back in the day, I was one of those Jesus freaks and proud of it, and if you don't know what I'm talking about, don't worry about it. But Toby Mac wrote this song because he lost his son. And I was caught in the tension of the moment that I'm listening to a station that prides itself in being encouraging and uplifting music for the whole family, while listening to a lament song. A song of why did you take him away? Does this belong on KTIS? And it made me think back to when Stephen Curtis Chapman lost his own child. Stephen Curtis Chapman, another artist more famous about 2 decades ago or even a decade ago on KTIS, but he's another one who wrote a song after losing his own child. And over the decades, I admit, I've been following Christian contemporary music, and I've seen when people who experienced something that didn't quite fit that encouraging and uplifting standard that Christian radio likes to maintain, like when Amy Grant got divorced, or when Jennifer Knapp came out, or when Jars of Clay started wondering about justice issues that weren't so mainstream evangelical. All of a sudden, you heard them less and less on contemporary radio. Encouraging and uplifting music. Why is that? Is that because our faith doesn't have a place for when things get hard? Well, I bring this up today because it's Thanksgiving week. We're entering the holidays. You, as well as I, may be tempted or encouraged to find all the things we're grateful for this week. But while you can think to yourself and muster the willpower to name the things you're grateful for on one hand, on the other hand, my guess is if you're like me, you can also come up with a number of things that you grieve this year. So my question for you today, is it wrong if you're a person of the Christian faith to grieve? Or should you just focus on what's uplifting and encouraging and deny the pain, the suffering, and pretend like it's not there? Does that mean that you're being truly faithful? Or does our faith have a way of being able to bring both grief and gratitude into the same place? So that's my question. For the answer, I invite us today to turn to Scripture. Now, there's many places in the Bible that we can turn to today, but there's a couple places that I want to reference. And the first is Job. As you think about Job, Job is this character in the Bible who was blameless and upright. He had everything going for him. And in chapter 1, all of a sudden, everything was lost. Everything, his kids, his property, his animals, his whole career lost. And it was him and his wife left. And somehow, Job, this inspiration of the faith, mustered the strength to say, at the end of chapter 1, he gives and he takes away, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Job gives gratitude to God even though he just lost everything. And while we look to Job as an inspiration in this moment, what we find is that his grief was not eliminated by his gratitude. In fact, after he said this line, he giveth and taketh away, blessed be the name of the Lord. It's almost like his grief gave him, his gratitude gave him permission to grieve. Because in the next 40 chapters, Job is trying to make sense of what happened. He's trying to figure out, how could this possibly happen to me? He's lamenting, he's grieving for the next 40 chapters, and his friends try to explain it away. They try to say there's a reason for everything, but Job says, look, it's not that simple. This shouldn't have happened. It shouldn't have happened to me. You see, his gratitude gave him permission to grieve. Grief and gratitude for Job were not at odds with one another. In another place where we see a lot of gratitude and praise and thanksgiving is in the Psalms. But if we look to the Psalms, it's not all just giving praise to God. Gratitude is woven into the fabric of a psalm that also has lament and mourning. Take, for instance, Psalm 22. Psalm 22 says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. You see, the psalmist is lamenting and grieving, God, why are you not here? And then the psalmist says, yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. And you, our ancestors, trusted. They trusted, you delivered them. So there is grief, and then there is a yet, and then gratitude. And then followed by a but. I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. So my God, why have you forsaken me? Grief. Yet you are enthroned on the praises of Israel. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others, despised by the people. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. You see, there's this bouncing back from grief to gratitude. Grief. Yet. Gratitude, but grief, yet gratitude, but O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. These are the Psalms. It's not a picture of just encouraging and uplifting music. It's a back and forth between grief and gratitude. These two are woven together throughout the Psalms. I think also of 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians is a popular passage when it comes to giving thanks to God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 says this, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. That's a strong permission to be grateful. However, the context is worth noting. Because in chapter 4, Paul indicates to what context he's preaching. He's giving this letter. It says, chapter 4, verse 13, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died. And if we learn about this a little bit more, there were people that were being killed because of their faith. These were martyrs. So Paul is writing to them in the context of recognizing that people they loved have died. So he said, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. Now, he doesn't say, so that you may not grieve. He says, we do not want you to grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. So Paul says, grieve. But just don't grieve as those who have no hope. And it's the grief in chapter 4 that gives permission for the gratitude that give thanks in all circumstances in chapter 5. And I think the same is true on the night in which he was betrayed. Our Lord Jesus Christ sat there with his disciples. He knew that one would betray him. He knew that one would deny him. He knew that he was going to be crucified the next day. But we think of the context and what happened. Say with me the words if you know them. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, gave thanks. He gave thanks. He was grateful. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper again, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, on the night that he was betrayed, that he was denied, that people were grieving the fact that he was to be crucified, he was grateful. Folks, I hope you see in Job, in the Psalms, in 1 Thessalonians, on Monday, Thursday, in each of these cases, grief and gratitude belong in some ways together. Being faithful to God is not about denying our grief. Being faithful involves having permission to grieve like Job, because of our gratitude to God for what we have. And bouncing back and forth between the buts and the yets, like the Psalms. My God, why have you forsaken me? Yet it was you who formed me in my mother's womb. Or for Paul, because of the grief of those who died, we confess that we have reason still to grieve, but just not as those without hope. We grieve and give thanks in all circumstances. One last example. You've heard of the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness? Great is Thy Faithfulness. Well, you know where that comes from in the Bible? That comes from a book called Lamentations. So Lamentations has 5 chapters. And what's interesting about Lamentations is it's very symmetrical. So if you open it up, Lamentations, it's got 5 chapters, and chapter 1's got 22 verses. Chapter 2 has 22 verses. Chapter 3 has 66, which is 3 times 22 verses. Chapter 4 has 22 verses. And chapter 5 has 22 verses. So 22, 22, 66, 22, 22. This is all very intentional and very structured in the composition of Lamentations. And if you look at the book, chapter 1, verse 1 says, how lonely sits the city that once was full of people. There's a grief declared right away, chapter 1, verse 1. And if you look to the end, chapter 5, verse 20, says, why have you forgotten us completely? God, why have you forsaken us these many days? Restore us to yourself, O Lord, that we may be restored. Renew our days as of old, unless you have utterly rejected us and are angry with us beyond measure. That's how it ends. And in between verse 1 of chapter 1 and verse 22 of chapter 5, there's lament and grief. Lament and grief, except right smack dab in the middle. Chapter 3, verse 22. Right in the middle. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. You see, gratitude doesn't eliminate grief. In fact, gratitude, like in the context of Job, gives permission for grief. And in the middle of our grief, like in the book of Lamentations, we can pause to be grateful. And I don't know about you, but that's kind of how I feel this year at Thanksgiving. I'm grieving a lot. However, my grief and my gratitude can belong together. And I think in the Bible we see this over and over again, that grief and gratitude don't have to be opposites. Your faith doesn't have to be confined to encouraging and uplifting words. Faith incorporates the high highs and the low lows and the recognition and the acknowledgement that our life includes both. And so if God is to receive us as we are, God's got to give space for both too. So as we prepare for the holidays this year, maybe you're the kind of person who wants your family to know that because of their faith in Jesus Christ, they can be happy and they can be encouraged and uplifted. And you want people around you to count their blessings and to see the cup half full, which is wonderful. However, I invite you to recognize that it's okay to give voice to grief and lament. In fact, it's biblical. The psalmist doesn't crop out the my God, why have you forsaken me parts. Those are integrally woven into the psalmist cries. And the words of gratitude from Job gave him permission to grieve. And I invite you, if you want to focus just on the blessings and the gratitude, to recognize that there's reason for people to grieve this year. In many of those ways we don't even quite understand, but we feel. But if you're on the other side and you are so overcome by your frustration and sorrow and pain this year, by the pain that you can't be with loved ones, by the pain that you're missing a loved one who may have died this year, by the pain that even if you could be with loved ones, they're so polarized and divided because of politics this year that you wouldn't even want to be in one another's presence, and yet you need each other and you know that, but you're so torn apart that it breaks your heart and you just want to wallow in that grief. My invitation for you today is to know that there is a place for your grief and your lament with God. It's not anti-faith to be sad, mad, or wishing and longing for a day where you weren't so overwhelmed, frustrated, and exposed to the suffering in this world. You can bring that to God. But I also invite you to recognize that you don't have to dismiss your grief in order to pause for even a minute. To pause in between chapters 1 and 5, chapters 2 and 4, to pause at chapter 3 to say, "Great is thy faithfulness." And to recognize that God is with you and God is giving you encouragement and support and blessings even while you're overwhelmed and frustrated and suffering. God is still with you. So today, as we prepare for the holidays, my prayer for you, my prayer for me, is that we can give each other permission in the faith to have space for both grief and gratitude. Amen. Thank you.
is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Now may we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, our Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
now may we gather our first and best in offering to the Lord. Please join me as we say together our Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now as you go on your way today, be comforted in knowing that Christ does go with you. May he go before you to show you the way, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you watching over you, and within you to give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord, thanks be to God.
Mm-hmm.